So the song says the mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe, 'cause yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. I love this when y'all, it says, and bodies are still being raised. Woo! Giants are still being slain. God, we believe, yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Say, we are here for you. Come and do what you do. Woo! We set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do. 'Cause we need a move. We need a move. We need a move. Yeah. We need a move. And bodies are still being raised. Hey! Giants are
welcome to this evening's Bible study and prayer service coming to you from Perez Chapel International, Almira. My name is Victor Anyete Patterson. This evening, we've come your way once again with the Word of God. We're going to get into the Word of God. Believe God that by His Spirit, He would direct us, grant us understanding into His Word, so that we would become enlightened, empowered to be able to do that which we are created to do. Your life would not be the same. My life would not be the same. I'm just believing, God, that as you hear the Word of God, you would also be a doer of the Word. It is very important that whatever we hear, we practice, because it is not what you hear, just hear, that profits you, but it is that which you put into practice. You can have scriptures, understanding into God's Word, but if you do not put it into practice, it does not do you good. It is just like you having seeds that you have not sown. So I encourage you that we would all, as we encounter the Word of God, learn and discipline ourselves to be doers of the Word and not just hearers. Hallelujah. Let's just, as usual, take some time to thank God and to bless Him for His goodness. You want to lift your voice and glorify the name of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is worthy of all praise. There is none to be compared to Him. He is our God, our Keeper, our Savior, the one who created the heavens and the earth, ourselves being part of His creation. You want to lift up your voice and you want to thank Him. You want to glorify His name. You want to say, Father, I thank you and I bless you for my life. Thank you and I bless you for the good things that you have done for me and continue to do. You want to bless Him. You want to glorify the name of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is worthy. I'd like to also take this opportunity to welcome our viewers on Facebook Live. Welcome. If you are also on YouTube, welcome. We are live on YouTube, on Facebook, and also on Zoom. So any of the networks you are on, welcome to this evening's Bible study and prayer service. So we were just worshiping God, thanking Him and blessing Him for the things that He is doing for us. I believe that there are many things that God does for us that sometimes we take for granted. So I would like to encourage you, don't take the things that God does for you for granted, because it is only God who is able to sustain us. It is He who is able to keep us. So I pray that you would come to the realization that you need God more than any other thing. Amen. So let's open our mouths. Let's thank Him for life. Let's thank Him for His goodness. Let's thank Him for His faithfulness. God is really faithful. He has been good to us. He has kept us, provided for us. And I know that your life is never the same as you continue to commit yourself to the Word of God. He continues to keep us. He continues to protect us. He continues to save us. So open your mouth. Let us give Him thanks. Open your mouth. Let us bless His name. He is worthy of all praise. Open your mouth and just love Him. He is worthy. Yes, give Him praise. Give Him praise. Give Him praise. Give Him praise. And share the link so that others would also join in to be a blessing, to receive the Word of God and by the Word of God be blessed. Open your mouth and thank Him. Thank Him for His goodness. Thank Him for the things that He's doing for us. Thank Him that He is protecting us. Thank Him that He kept us. Thank Him that His love for us supersedes and breaks everything that comes to distract us and everything that comes to take us away, sway us away from His will. It is He who has protected us. Faith comes by hearing and by hearing the Word of God. But without the Spirit of God, you would not be able to connect and understand the Word of God. I pray this evening that your life would not be the same as we commit ourselves to the Word of God, that the Lord Himself will keep us. He would bless us in the name of Jesus. Yes, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for our lives, for our families. We thank you. We glorify your name. We are so grateful and thankful for that which you have done for us. Being alive alone is a blessing. Being alive alone is a blessing. So continue to thank him. Thank him for clothes on your body, food on the table. Thank him for even shelter over your head. It is God who has done all of these things, and he is worthy of all praise. We ought to thank him. We want to bless him. He has protected us from accidents. He has kept us from any unwanted, any unpleasant situation. So open your mouth and bless him. Open your mouth and thank him. Open your mouth and glorify him. When I think of the good things that the Lord has done for me and for my family, and I know that he has also done the same for you and for your family, I believe that you would have a cause to thank him. You would have a cause to bless him. You would have a cause to glorify him, because he's worthy of it. If you think about how great God is, though Jesus, being God, came down to die for you and I, our salvation alone deserves to be appreciated. Amen. So open your mouth and thank him for salvation. Open your mouth and bless him for the good things that he has done. It is more important we are saved than even riches, than even prosperity, than physical things, because our eternal destination is more important than the physical. Our eternal destination is more important than whatever riches we can gather on this earth. So open your mouth and thank him. Open your mouth and love him. Bless him, because he's worthy of our praise. He's worthy of the thanks that we bring to him. Father, we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. And as we gather this evening, Lord, we lift praise to you. We lift thanksgiving to you. Our hearts are filled with joy, gratitude unto you for this week. Oh, from Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday to Friday. Today is the 23rd day of April 2021, the fourth month of the year. And I believe that God deserves to be thanked. God deserves to be praised for keeping us and for protecting us until this time. Just open your mouth and glorify him. He's worthy. He's worthy. The Lord is worthy of our praise. He is worthy of honor. He's worthy. Just bless him. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. He is glorious in holiness. When I think about the good things that he has done, all the things that he is even about to do in my life, then I want to just thank him, make a joyful noise unto him, shout aloud so that everybody would hear my voice, because I know that the Lord has been good to me. He has been good to you. We want to continue to thank God for leadership. We want to thank God for our prime minister in this country, for all leaders worldwide in all countries, in Africa, in Europe, in Americas, everywhere that you can think about, all leaders. We want to thank God and commit their lives into the hands of God, that God will continuously protect them and endow them with wisdom, heavenly wisdom, so that their leadership would be profitable to us in the name of Jesus. The word of God says that we should pray for them who are in authority, so that we would have a peaceable or live a peaceable life. Hallelujah. So open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and thank God for their life. They might be making some mistakes, making some decisions, taking some decisions that you might not agree, but do you know why they are taking those decisions? When you have not sat in a place of authority, you think it's easy. But when you sit in a place of authority, you realize how difficult it is. So open your mouth and thank God for presidents. Thank God for prime ministers. Thank God for kings. Thank God for elders. Thank God for leaders in the mighty name of Jesus. We want to also take time to pray for spiritual leadership in the mighty name of Jesus. You want to thank God that God has set spiritual leadership over us, that govern in the spiritual realms and stand in places of authority, so that the atmosphere, the spiritual atmosphere, will not be contaminated. You realize that life is not about only the physical. The most important thing about life is even the spiritual. So open your mouth and thank God for spiritual leaders, for pastors, for elders, for deacons, for church workers. Open your mouth for bishops, for apostles, prophets, evangelists. Open your mouth. Let's thank thank God for their lives in the mighty name of Jesus. So we bless God for spiritual leaders. We thank God for, and we ask, oh Lord, that any one of them that are going through any physical, any health challenges, we lift them before you and we come against that infirmity, that spirit of infirmity, and we rebuke it in the mighty name of Jesus. We ask in the name of Jesus that, Lord, you would deliver them from the hands of infirmities and the spirit behind it in the name of Jesus. Restore their health in the name of Jesus. We want to pray for our families and friends and ask for the protection of God over their lives in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth. And if you have any desire on your heart, this is the right time for you to open your mouth and to pray. There is a set time for everything. And as you open your mouth and you thank God and bless Him for your life, also bringing your petitions before Him, the Lord is good. He would answer speedily according to His times and seasons. He would answer us in the mighty name of Jesus. Open your mouth and bless Him. Give Him praise and give Him praise. I want to take some time also to pray for the city of Amsterdam where we live in, the city of Almere. We want to pray for the Netherlands, for Ghana, for Nigeria, for Gabon, for Togo, Benin. We want to pray for anywhere you know someone that lives there, Nigeria. We pray for the nations that the Lord will cause a revival to break forth, a revival to break forth that will bring in a great harvest into the kingdom in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. Yes, in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for nations. We thank you for leaders. We thank you for the believers in the nations, and we ask in the name of Jesus that you grant them boldness to be able to deliver and to speak your word without any fear, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus. And when they speak your word in truth, oh Lord, may their words not fall to the ground in the name of Jesus. We want to take some short time also to pray for the young people, the younger generation, the youth. We want to pray that the love for the word of God will be shared abroad in their heart. They will be consumed rather for the desire for the word of God and not for earthly things, not for technology. That even when they are desiring for technology, they are desiring to be able to use it to enhance the kingdom in the name of Jesus. So pray for the youths, pray for young believers, pray for the young upcoming adults in the name of Jesus, that they would rather opt for the kingdom, opt for the word of God instead of going their own way and doing their own thing in the name of Jesus, because they are the next generation. If they do not carry this thing, the gospel, ahead and follow us as we also follow the Lord, this thing will die off in the name of Jesus. So open your mouth and pray for them. Intercede for your children. Intercede for your teenage children. Intercede for them in the name of Jesus. Father, I plead, O Lord, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you would cause, O Lord, a revival to break forth among the youngsters in the name of Jesus, that they would desire for the word of God as never before. They would desire for the word of God than any other thing, than physical things, than technology, than anything that you can think about. Better to be established in the kingdom of God than to be prosperous out there in the world. So open your mouth and pray for them. Any spirit that seems to deter them, any spirit that seems to take their mind off the things of God, we bind that spirit in the name of Jesus, and we ask in the name of Jesus that the will of God be done in their lives in the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and pray. Open your mouth and pray. And then let us also thank God for answered prayer. And if you have any prayer topics, you can just go into our live chats link and drop the prayer topic as we pray for you and pray with you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. So, Father, we thank you for this evening. We bless you for your love shared abroad and your peace that you have given us, even in the midst of this pandemic. We ask in the name of Jesus that your glory will be shown over us, that your peace will be with us as never before. And as we get into your word, oh Lord, may your word bring illumination where there is darkness. May your word bring understanding where there is confusion. Grant us wisdom from the depths of the heart of the spirit of your word. In the mighty name of Jesus, we have prayed. In Jesus' mighty name, hallelujah. Amen. We thank God for another wonderful evening of Bible study. We are continuing where we left off last week. I was talking about the law because I think today we'll get into the dedication finally. Amen. Because we've been going round and round. We've not gotten there yet. But today I believe God will bring us there. Amen. So amen. I wanted to deal with the law so we would understand what we have been delivered from. Sometimes when you don't know what you've been delivered from and the joy and the peace that we have in the Lord, then you do not appreciate where God is taking you. Amen. So that is the reason why we went to deal with the law. And I established that the law is like a teacher that made us aware. The law was not there before sin. It was the because of sin that God established or gave the laws. Amen. God realized that the way sin was abounding, there should be a check and a balance. So he gave his laws so that if you obeyed the law, then you stand right with God. In the Old Testament, I'm referring to the Old Testament, and that even when you failed in one, you are failed in all. So it took the grace of God and the manifestation of Jesus in human nature and coming to pay that price for us to be delivered from the hands of sin so that we will be set free to be able to worship God. Hallelujah. So the law was not made to accommodate sin. Laws are not made to accommodate sin. Laws are made to make us aware. So the Bible talks about the fact that the law was like a school teacher holding our hands and governing us and keeping us until the manifestation of the seed and we believe in through faith. Hallelujah. So I talked about the fact that Jesus came to fulfill the law. And when you talk about fulfillment of the law, it is not like coming to top it up, but to meet its requirements. So the Bible says that it is he who sins that has to die. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And it is sin that separated us from God. Amen. In the Garden of Eden, when God created everything in its originality, there was fellowship between man and God. But disobedience separated us from God. Amen. Disobedience. Thou shalt not eat of this fruit. And our father Adam, through Eve, being deceived by the serpent who was incarnated by the devil, ate the fruit, and eventually we were also in the loins of Adam, and because of that we were also sinning as Adam disobeyed and sinned against God. Amen. So we have talked about this. I keep repeating it because it is very important for us to understand that it was the fall of man that brought about the separation of man from God. Amen. So Jesus, there should be the payment. There was the need for the payment of that sin because something has gone wrong and it needed to be restored. So when you look at the book of Genesis, it talks about creation, talks about the fall, talks about the restoration and the promise of the restoration where God came in and actually pronounced Jesus into being. Amen. That the seed of the woman, it wasn't the seeds of the woman. It was the seed of a woman, of the woman. That talking about Jesus Christ coming down onto earth to pay the price so that we would be set free from the bondage of sin. And I've talked about how that sin is what held us bondage. Amen. It was sin that held us bondage. If you should go back to the teachings that I did on death, sin, and captivity, you'd be able to find more details in there. So Jesus first had to fulfill the requirements of the law. And the requirements of the law were that he who sinned has to die. There had to be the shedding of blood. In the Old Testament, once every year, the high priest would take a sacrifice, go into the Holy of Holies with all the ceremonies, and had to sacrifice with the expectation that the nation of Israel's sins or sin would be covered, not forgiven, but covered. Amen. Not forgiven, but covered. And when you fast forward it and you come into the New Testament, in the book of Hebrews, you realize that Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice, the Lamb of God, and the high priest himself. He, the high priest, and the Lamb gave and sacrificed himself once and for all so that that sin will be taken care of. This time, not to be covered, but to be paid, because in the Old Testament, they were using animals to do that. And the animals were not the ones that sinned. So it was a shadow. Amen. So you remember last week I was talking about shadow. So when you don't have the original thing, you use something to replace it. It was a replacement. Amen. So in the Old Testament, they had to use the blood of animals to pacify. Let me put it that way. To pacify God. Amen. But there needed to be the sacrifice of a human being, the death of a human being, to be able, the shedding of the blood of a human being, for the sins of human race to be taken care of. Amen. And that is what Jesus did for us. And when he paid and met the requirements of the law, he fulfilled the law, lived a sinless life, and eventually paid the price, went to the cross, died on our behalf, shed his blood, and he said it was finished. It meant that he had fulfilled all the requirements of the law. Amen. And apart from the moral laws, all of the other laws became null and void. They were abolished. Let me put it that way. The ceremonial laws and apart from the moral laws, I talked about this 2 weeks ago back. The moral law. So when you look into the New Testament, you realize that in the New Testament, it is not more about let's go into a temple and sacrifice things. You have to be in a particular position to worship. You have to be in a particular place to worship. You have to go to a priest to be sanctified and all of those things. No, the Holy of Holies is now accessible to anyone who believes what Jesus has done. Amen. Amen. So all of those ceremonial things that were being done in the Old Testament were taken care of by the blood and by Jesus's fulfillment, his sinless life, walking this earth, and as an example to show to us that it is possible to please God without sinning. Amen. And going to the cross and being resurrected by the Spirit of God on the third day, he paid the price and fulfilled it. So all of those sacrifices, ceremonial laws, and all of them were abolished. Amen. If you are close to your partner or your wife at home, say they were abolished. They were totally taken care of and thrown away. So you need not. So you realize that in John chapter 4, that from the verse number 20 all the way to like 25, 26, Jesus' encounter with the woman, the Samaritan woman. The Bible says that from the verse number 20, it says that our fathers worshipped on this mountain. And you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship. So to the Samaritan, it was a particular place that they should worship. To the Jews in Judaism should be Jerusalem. Till today, those who practice Judaism still had, when they are praying, they had to pray facing the temple. Amen. Particular religious organizations, or let me say religion, teaches some people or instructs some people to pray facing the east I don't want to mention any religion's name, but you can understand what I'm talking about. Amen. But Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father." Amen. Hallelujah. So neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. So it no longer was it a particular place. All of those places, all of those symbols where before you can sacrifice unto God, you needed a priest before you can sacrifice unto God. I wanted to come to us with just the five major offerings that needed to be done. The sin offering, the grain offering. So just you in the Old Testament wanting to give something, come to God, the types of offerings that you have to go through, even guilt offering. For us to understand, so we are going to deal with dedication, but if you know what you have been delivered from, it makes you appreciate what you have. Amen. It makes you appreciate what you have. Because when you don't know where you are coming from and what you have been delivered from, somebody will tell you are still in bondage. Because if we were still in bondage under the Old Testament, then we should be practicing. When you are coming to church, you should be coming with a goat, with a fowl. Because you have to sanctify yourself before you enter the temple. And no longer do we see the church, the building, as the church. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So when we gather, the church, the building, is just a place of gathering for the church. So it is when two or three are gathered in the name of Jesus that the church has gathered. Amen. When two or three are gathered. So you are the church. You come with the Holy Spirit. I come with the Holy Spirit in me. That is why Jesus said it was expedient for him to leave, so that the Holy Spirit can come into all of us. Amen. So now the Holy Spirit comes into us and empowers us, makes us the temple of God. That is why eventually when we start dealing with dedication, setting your body apart for him, you would understand it, because he has delivered you from something. Hallelujah. If you were slave to sin and I come to deliver you from sin, don't you think you owe me? So we do not own ourselves, as the scripture says, because we did not deliver ourselves. It was Jesus who delivered us. So we became the body of Christ. Amen. We became the body of Christ. So some of the things that we were delivered from, as I was dealing with last week, we are delivered from all of these feasts. So all of the feasts, the Passover feasts, and that this feast and that feast, and the feasts of the unleavened bread, and this, all of those things, we were delivered from them. Amen. Hallelujah. So the next thing that we were doing, all of the sacrifices, they were all a shadow in the Old Testament. They were all a shadow, and all of them have been abolished because they were once for all time fulfilled and replaced by the unique and special final sacrifice of atonement of Christ on the cross. So he stood in that place. When the Bible talks about fulfillment, all of those sacrifices that needed to be done yearly, the sin offering, the guilt offering, where they would take an animal, the sin offering, and pass the animal all around their head and kill the animal. You would come with the goat, lay your hands on the animal, and then, in quote, your sin is transferred to the animal before they sacrifice the animal. All of those sacrifices were abolished because Jesus became the perfect sacrifice for you and I. Hallelujah. So it was a shadow preparing itself for the real manifestation and the real sacrifice to be given. Hallelujah. So let's look at one or two scriptures to confirm what I just talked about. Let's look at John chapter 1, verse number 29. The Gospel of John chapter 1. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." He did not say the sins of the world. He said the sin, because it was that sin of disobedience that was being dealt with. If you have heard me do Bible studies and I've talked about sin, I keep saying that sin is a personality. Sin is not plural. Sin is not the deeds you do. It is a spirit that manipulates you, and the results of that spirit having control over you is the things you do. Amen. So sin is trespassing. So once you disobey God, that the power, that spirit takes over you, and that spirit now moves you into doing all of the things that you do. So the things you do are as a result of your disobedience to God. Amen. Hallelujah. So let's also look at, he's the lamb, the perfect lamb that takes away the sins. Hebrews chapter 7, verse number 27. If you have any questions, you can type the question in the chat so that we can deal with it. Amen. Hallelujah. Verse number 27 I mentioned. Yeah. Who does not need daily as those high priests? So go one verse back, verse number 26. For such a high priest was fitting for us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and has become higher than the heavens, who does not need daily or continuously as those high priests to offer up sacrifices, first for himself or for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once for all when he offered up himself. In the Old Testament, the high priest had to go continuously. When they wake up in the morning, they have to sanctify themselves because they were not even sure if they were living right. So first, they had to go through all the ceremonies. Actually, God even prescribed particular clothes that they should wear when they were coming into his presence. How they should wash themselves. All of those sacrifices, all of those routines, Jesus' death took away. Amen. Because we no longer need to do that. Hallelujah. So Jesus offered himself up once and for all. He became the perfect sacrifice, and we need not do it over and over again. For instance, the firstborn and the first fruits, a shadow. It's also a shadow. Hallelujah. It's also a shadow. Circumcision, also a shadow. All of these shadows have been taken care of so that we would have liberty and freedom from that bondage. Amen. Can you imagine how stressful it would have been? Our Christian life would have been. Every day you wake up, you have to go through a ceremony. Amen. You have to, you don't eat this, don't eat that, you know, clean food, unclean food, and all of those things. But Jesus, by the sacrifice and he offering himself, took away all of this, and he set us free. Amen. So, let us bring it all down to this. If you are set free from something and you do not commit yourself to the right way of doing the same thing, let me put it that way, you are still not holy. Holiness is not abstinence from sin. Holiness is abstinence from sin, in quote, or deliverance from sin, but the dedication and commitment to doing right. Because if you know to do right and you do not do it, it is sin. That is why we need the Holy Spirit. So that the Holy Spirit empowers us for us to be able to do the right thing, not being conscious of the law. The law will still be there. Without laws, people would misbehave. I have given this example. The Israelites had in all over 613 ceremonial laws, and all of those laws, moral laws, thou shalt not do this, all of that, how to wash yourself, how to even talk to your parents, and all of those things, they were all there. Why? Because of the level of sin. Where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. Okay. Holland, for instance, has over 3,000 laws in this land that we live in. Do you think our sins are greater than the Israelites or not? If they had 600 plus and we now have 3,000, it tells you we have graduated. We have entered into another level. That is why we need Jesus. That is why you need Jesus. If you are watching me, wherever you are, you need Jesus. Hallelujah. You need Jesus. Without Jesus, you would not be able to sustain yourself. Without Jesus, you are going nowhere to happen. We all need Jesus. We all need Jesus. Because if he does not deliver us from this sinful world, we would not be able to make it on our own. Amen. So if he has delivered us from something, then he is bringing us into something. Amen. Because Amen. Jesus talked about how that when even you have been delivered of an evil spirit and you do not feel the vacuum with the Spirit of God, that is why deliverance ministers every year have to come and deliver you. Because, not me, no, me, no. Because what we do is that when we are delivered, we go back and practice whatever we were practicing yesterday before we were delivered. So at the end of the day, we are worse off. Don't you see that last year when they came for the deliverance service? This year when they come, they take more time to deliver you than last year. Because the demons have come in with seven more wicked ones. We Christians cannot work together. But demons agree and work together because they have one purpose. Their purpose is to make sure that whatever area, territory they conquer, they hold on to it. They will not let it go. So Jesus said that if you are delivered from an evil spirit, it goes round looking for a place to go and stay. If it does not find a place, I pray you would not open yourself up for any possession of a demon. Because when they possess you, they find a resting place in you. They do not want to leave. When they are cast out, they go round. If they don't find any place to stay, they would come back. And when they come and the Holy Spirit is not dominant, the Holy Spirit is not in charge of your spirit, they come, they go and invite seven more wicked ones. And they come and make their abode in that place. And your state, your latter state becomes worse off than the former. May God deliver us. May he, by his spirit, help us to be able to hold and keep ourselves. And as we have fellowship with the word washes us. The word keeps us. And as we allow ourselves to rather be moved and possessed by the Holy Spirit, no other demon will be able to come and possess us. Amen. So you avail yourself to the Holy Spirit, and no other demon can come and struggle with the Holy Spirit. But if you do not yield to the Holy Spirit and you leave yourself open and vulnerable, then they would go and come back. And your state presently will be worse off than former. Hallelujah. So he delivers us to bring us into purity. He delivers us out of the will of God. So the Bible says that he has taken us out of darkness into his marvelous light. The light is the illumination. The light is the enlightenment. The light is the knowledge of the word of God that brings us into the place of fellowship with God. That brings us into the place of fellowship with God. Amen. Without the light, we would be in darkness. Amen. So let's look now at dedication. Where we now have been set free from the law, we have been delivered from darkness, we have come into the light. What is dedication? what is dedication. So it will help us to appreciate when the Bible is asking us to dedicate our members unto God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. So dedication. Dedication means to give oneself to something or someone. It means to commit yourself completely to God. And I mean the God of the Bible. Let me put it that way so you understand it. Not any other God, but the God of the Bible. Amen. To his kingship and to what pleases him, not us. Amen. We serve God in spirit and not in the flesh. So God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. And we should worship him in spirit in accordance to how the Holy Spirit leads us. Amen. I'll be paraphrasing some of these scriptures. The Bible says that who knows the mind of God but his spirit. So if it is his spirit that is leading us, then he will lead us according to the mind of God, according to the will of God, and according to the purpose of God. Amen. Any other spirit will not lead us the right way. Hallelujah. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, chapter 3, verse number 6. Chapter 3, verse number 6. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
2 Corinthians, he says, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the spirit. For the letter kills, but the spirit gives life. So it is not about the logos, it's about the rhema. Amen. When you dive more into the logos and you are being led by the spirit of God, he reveals the secrets of the logos, the deep things, better understanding of the logos. It becomes a rhema, a revelation to us. Amen. Because we are led by the Spirit. If we are led by the Spirit, we never go wrong. Amen. I'm not talking about screaming and jumping in church. You can scream and jump and somersault and do all of those things and still not be led by the Spirit. Yeah. If after all those gymnastics, you still lie and gossip, you are not being led by the Spirit. Oh, don't tell me that, oh, I have a weakness, please. You have a weakness, but are you led by the Spirit? Amen? Are you led by the Spirit? Amen. So the Holy Spirit leads us according to the will and the mind and the purpose of God. Hallelujah. So we ought to stick to the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. We ought to stick with him. We have to have fellowship with him. So let's look. We are human beings, are three in one, spirit, soul, and body. So in our dedication, we should be dedicating all our three different natures unto God. Hallelujah. So let's start with dedication of our bodies. Dedication of our bodies. Hallelujah. The Bible says in Romans chapter number 12, verse number 1. Let's read that scripture and then we'll read chapter 6, verse number 12 to 13. It says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. So now a sacrifice. Holy, acceptable, which is your reasonable service. Reasonable. He did not say it's a tedious service. He says, which is your reasonable. That is the standard you can do. Amen. That is the standard you can do. A reasonable service. Amen. Romans chapter 6, verse number 12 to 13. And then after that, we'll read the verse number 19. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. 13. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourself to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Amen. And your members as instruments of righteousness. Let's look at, let's do the 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Okay, so you see how that he delivers you from the law, but he expects you to dedicate yourself to God. Amen. If you do not dedicate yourself and give yourself totally to God, eventually you would fall back. Eventually you would fall back. Like what I was talking about, the demons coming, they've been cast out, they come back. Amen. They would come back. They are committed than some believers. Demons are committed than some believers. Some believers, our Christianity is some way. We can even stop church because we ourselves want to just stop. Amen. Some believers, our commitment and our consistency. If you look at the way demons are organized and their consistency in doing things, stop. Oh. Gone are the days when you dream. If you were writing down the time that you had the dreams, you realize that it was on that particular hour, that particular minute, that particular second that they keep coming at the same time to visit you in your dream. Particular time, consistent. But we, even coming to worship God who has delivered us, we come late. Even online, we come late. Online. Coming online when we all of us have agreed, let's meet 7, let's meet 8 online. No, we will come late. and one thing that we do that is funny, we think we are deceiving God, but deceiving ourselves. You log in, mute your microphone, turn off the video, and keep the phone somewhere and be cooking and be doing something else. God have mercy on us. We don't know what we are doing to ourselves. Let's look at the verse number 19. So I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness and of lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness for holiness. Stop. Oh, when we were in the world. Yeah, stop. Stop. We were doing the thing decently. Correct. Disco, correct. When we are going to the disco, look at how we dress. We would dress well for the disco. And when we are going, we will get drunk because disco and drunkenness, they go together. But you now, you are a believer. You are coming to church, give offering. You say, no. Give tithe. No. Tithe, I will not pay. I will not give. Why? Doesn't it go with your righteousness? He says that when you were in the flesh, you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness. You did it perfectly. Now you are in the Lord. Why don't you want to do it in righteousness and in holiness? Amen. Why don't you want to do it? Dedication. We are talking about dedication here. Dedication. When we are talking about dedicating our members, our bodies. Amen. Dedicating our bodies. Here, our bodies. Hey, God, have mercy on us. Our bodies. And when he talks about our bodies, he's not only talking about just the physical body, but your spirit. Because that is where the demon wants to come and dwell in. That is where the demon wants to come in. Your personality. Dedicate your personality unto God. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And it should be a sacrifice. Amen. Should be a sacrifice. Amen. So if it's a sacrifice, it should be a holy one. Like Romans chapter 1, verse number I mean, Romans chapter 12, verse number 1 was saying, it should be a holy sacrifice. Amen. A holy sacrifice. That is what where I'm picking this from. It should be holy. It's a sacrifice, but it should be a holy one. It shouldn't be with impurities. It should be pure, bringing it unto God, because God is holy. He says that, I be ye holy because I am holy. If it is not possible, he will not ask you to do it. Hallelujah. Be ye holy because I am holy. God is holy. So we have to present a holy sacrifice. Our bodies should be holy and pure, coming to God. Hallelujah. Amen. Coming to God. And I've already said that holiness, the word holiness means to separate and to dedicate. To separate and to dedicate. You separate from sin, you dedicate yourself to purity. Amen. You separate yourself from impurity, you dedicate yourself to purity. You separate yourself from profanity, you dedicate yourself to speeches that are pure. Amen.
Amen.
The next point is, it should be a sacrifice that is pleasing to God. You cannot say, God, this is what I have, take it or leave it. No. God should be pleased with it.
Amen.
God should be pleased with it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God should be pleased with it. You cannot just say, oh, yeah, just as I am, I have come. God, take it or leave it. Yeah, no. God does not take it or leave it. You yourself, what you are presenting, your body that you are presenting, do you realize it's pure? Do you think it is pure? Or anything goes? No. God is not mocked. What a man soweth, that he would reap. Amen. So you present a pure, a pleasing sacrifice to God. Amen. If God in the Old Testament will not accept the sacrifices that they brought to him when they were not pure. Oh, thank you, Jesus. In the Old Testament, you don't bring a sick animal to sacrifice to God. That is what is happening here. So if you are bringing something to God, your body to God, it has to be clean. It has to be pure. It has to be set apart only for God. Hallelujah. Set apart only for God. It has to be pleasing to God. Amen. And then it becomes a spiritual act of worship. A spiritual act, that process of you cleansing yourself, making sure you are pure, not physical cleansing as in bathing, which is good, amen, but cleansing your conscience, cleansing yourself, and cleansing the body before you bring the body as a living sacrifice unto God. And it has to be acceptable. If God is not accepting it, it means there is something wrong with it. Amen. Hallelujah. So that is dedicating or setting the body apart for him. Amen. Setting the body apart for him. And then the next area you have to dedicate to God is your mind. The next area you have to dedicate unto God is your mind. Hallelujah. Your mind. We do not allow ourselves to be molded or shaped or fashioned after the pattern of this world. You are not of this world. Though you are in this world, you are not of this world. It means that you are not of the kind of the world. You are different. Amen. So your mind should not think like the way the world thinks. So in Romans chapter 12, verse number 2, he goes on to say that, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Not only is it good, acceptable, then eventually it becomes perfect. So you can choose to be good, but he wants it to be acceptable, and eventually it becomes perfect. Will of God. So if we are led by the Spirit, our thoughts will be in line with the Word of God, because we are feeding on the Word of God. Hallelujah.
Amen. We are feeding on the word of God. A Christian has to stay away from even friends that will pollute your thinking capacity. Amen. You have to. That is why the Bible says that we should not be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. Ask any believer, very good believer, even a church goer who chooses to marry an unbeliever if the marriage works out. The percentage, very, very minute. Unless the unbeliever eventually becomes a believer. Those relationships, they do not become successful. If whatever the Bible says, listen, whatever the Bible says we should not do is not to punish us. It's rather to protect us. God's restrictions are his protection for us. When you go all the way back into the book of Genesis, when he said, don't eat of this, the fruit of the, from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. As long as they did not eat from it, they did not know the difference between good and evil. I would believe they were doing things that was not in line with the will of God, but they did not even know. And because they did not know, God would not judge them with it. But the day they ate that fruit from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, their eyes were open. They now knew that this is right, this is wrong. Immediately, all along, they were naked. But immediately, now they were hiding from God. All along, the Bible says, in the cool of the evening, God will come into the garden and have fellowship with them. They were naked, did not know. They were not even conscious of their nakedness because God... they did not know it. But the day they ate that fruit, their eyes, they now became conscious of their nakedness. They now realize, I'm naked and I cannot go into the presence of God. I cannot stay in the presence of God. And they started hiding from God. Amen.
Amen.
So we ought to, in our minds, we should think right. If you think right, you would live right. Amen?
Yes.
Not only your body, your mind has to be dedicated to God. Amen?
Amen.
And also, you do not need to conform. Everybody is doing it. Conformity. So I'm also doing it. No. It is not your portion to be doing what everybody is doing. No, it is not. But rather be transformed, be changed, be renewed. You are born again. Fine. Your physical nature will not change, but as you receive the word of God daily, as you receive the word of God, as the word of God is preached, you accept it and you practice it. You accept it, you believe it, you practice it. You believe it, you practice it. Then you start changing. You start changing. You start changing. Before you know, you yourself will not even recognize yourself because now your speech will change. The way you talk, the way you handle things, the way you deal with situations will change. No doubt, I know for myself, if you move with a particular company of people, give yourself 1 week, 2 weeks, you start thinking and talking like them. It doesn't matter how matured you are or whatever. If you move with them for some time, listen, can two walk together, Amos 3:3, except they agree. If you have been working together for that long, there is something you agree on. There is something you agree on. So you will now accept, you see that you will be accepting some of the things. Oh, I was watching so and so. Then you too, when you come home, you are curious. You go and log in to go and check, to also go and watch. Then you also start watching what they are watching. You start dressing what the way they dress. You start doing what they do. Then gradually, you are gradually moving away. You're conforming. The Bible says they have a form of godliness, but they do not believe the power thereof. So you are conforming to the way they do things. May God deliver us from conformity.
Amen. Amen.
May God deliver us from conformity. I see sometimes it is, there is nothing wrong with it, that sometimes I think that we carry this thing too much. Then it's a color. You know, every church member should wear this color. Come on. Conformity. That does not make us pure. That does not make us holy. If it's for a celebration, fine. But do not conform to the world. But be ye renewed. Transformed, I mean, by the renewing of your mind. The renewing means that every day you receive a portion of the word of God. That is why we have the word force. Every day we take a chapter, we read. Gradually, before you know, you are reading a lot of scripture and you are being enlightened. Amen. There is this testimony someone shared. She just said that the wife, after being in Perez Chapel, Almira for some years, her behavior and the way she talks has changed. And it's a good testimony. It's better than a car. Because you can have cars and lose your marriage. Amen?
Amen.
So the word of God is very, very important. The word of God, very, very important. So be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Your mind can only be renewed by the information it receives. By the information it receives. And the information you receive sets you into thinking. And the Bible says that as a man thinketh, so is he. The information. Faith comes by hearing. So what you hear activates your faith, whether it is good or bad. Amen? When it's bad, it's fear. It will activate fear. It will activate criminality. It will activate negativity. Profanity. But the same information you received sets you into thinking. And what you think about sets you into motion, action to do. And when you do it, the results thereof comes. Amen. So your transformation is in the words you hear. No doubt. If somebody wants to program a group of people, all he has to do is be saying particular things to them. Sects do not just spring up. You gather the people. I love you. I want to. Oh, we are doing this. We are. Oh, come together. Let's do this together. Then gradually, then you start telling them, me, I'm untouchable. I am your God. It will look like it's funny in the beginning. You feel funny about it. Me, I'm your prophet. If you don't come to me, I'm not saying that your man of God is not coming from God. But what I mean is that where they gradually put themselves in the place of God. They put themselves in the place of God. Without me, don't eat. Without me, don't even sleep with your wife. Ask permission from me. All of these sex, that is what they do. Because I have to sanctify it for you. Sanctify it for you. And that is how sects come up. Can you imagine matured men, educated men will be in a sect and the leader will tell them, we want to go to heaven together, so let's die together. And they will die together. It's the words they heard. In the beginning, it will look funny, but gradually you would accept it. And as a man thinketh in his heart, so he is. Then gradually, that is what you are walking into. And when he tells you, let's do this, he does not need a gun. All he needs are words. That is the power of words. That is the power of words. When you met your wife, if you're a man, when you met your husband, if you're a woman, you see the words the guy told you. You are the milk that whitens my coffee. Without your sweetness, my porridge will lack its sweetness to sweeten my tongue. My wife thinks I don't have raps. I have them. Then they push you. Before you know, you do mumu. They press your mumu button. I love you too. Words you heard. words you heard. And you too, I love you too. Meanwhile, earlier, when you see the guy, look at his head like a coconut. The guy says, good afternoon. Oh, leave me. But when he starts telling you all of those sweet things, I know people. In the beginning of the dating, the guy is trying to woo them. Huh? They were enemies. And most of the time, that is the one. That one is nice. In the beginning, they look like petrol and matches. Like fire and petrol. Yeah, I don't like you. You are this. You look at your head. Even your head is not nice. You look at the way you walk. Wait. As long as you keep them around you and they talk to you, the words they will speak, then gradually, hey, he's not that bad, though. He said, cry, it's medium size. It's not small. Then gradually you start accepting it. Before you know you yourself, me too, I love you. Words. So that is why the Bible is saying that we should be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Because the state in which we were before we became born again was not in accordance with the word of God. So when you put in the word of God, put in the word of God, put in the word of God, then right now your mind, you are being transformed. And what you think about is what you would act upon. And what you act upon is what will bring your destiny. Amen. I hear people sing songs, change my destiny. God does not change destiny. He does not. God is not confused. The Bible says that before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you and I had ordained you a prophet. So how would you come out and now pray that God change my destiny? Destiny changer. Which destiny changer? He does not change destiny. He enhances or helps you to be able to fulfill your destiny. If it is dormant, come into the Lord, revive yourself, and the Lord will bring you there. He does not change destiny. God does not change. He has a destiny for you. Maybe it is not revealed. You don't know about it. Seek his mind concerning your life, so you would know the purpose for which God brought you onto this earth. One of the things that hinders us, it's not the fact that we do not have the Holy Spirit, but we do not ask the Holy Spirit to reveal who we are, why we are here to us. When we come into the Lord, we are okay with, you know, the religious activities. And eventually, you know, and somebody would confer onto you something that you should not be. A great man of God said, if you want to die quick, you become say you are called and become a pastor by force, whilst you are not called. If you are called, who should be the driver of the bus? If everybody is called, I know there is the global call, but you can still be a driver and evangelize. It's even more powerful. You are sitting in your bus instead of playing apuskeleke or whatever, keleke, you put in gospel music. In the middle of it, you have your microphone, you give them a word of encouragement, you bless them and help them. Gradually, you are at your work and you are ministering. Amen. If all of us goes into full-time ministry, no doubt that the churches are even more than the members. Where two or three are gathered, Jesus weeps ministries. It's a church. Jesus Christ. It's a church. Jesus heals. It's a church. I don't say we should not have, but are we all called into full-time ministry? So we have to be careful. Ask God, ask the Holy Spirit to lead you. You would serve, you would minister to people, but you can also have your profession and still minister. Paul was a great apostle. He made tents. Actually, his profession, he was a lawyer. You can understand. Luke, who wrote the book of Luke, was a physician. But they had good ministries. They followed Jesus. Amen. They did effective ministry. But because you have left what God gave to you to do, you are frustrated. As a man thinketh, so is he. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me see. The next thing we have to dedicate is our members. Dedication of our members. Like our eyes, our ears, our tongue. Amen. So let me finish that one quickly, then we'll be done with the dedication. Matthew chapter 6, verse number 22 to 23. Let's talk about the eye. I've talked about hearing. That is our thought, our mind. The Bible says that the lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body would be full of light. Amen. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in your darkness, if therefore the light that is in you is darkness, the light that is in you, which means your eye is darkness, how great is that darkness? The light that is in you, your light that is in you is darkness. How great is your darkness? Your darkness is darkness, darkness. May God have mercy on us. Amen. The eye is one of the entrance points into a human body, into us. So what you see determines what the thoughts that comes also into your mind. Not only hearing. Amen. What you see. So you see something, it prints a picture in your mind, and at the end of the day, you act on it. Amen. Amen. So you should be careful what you see. You should be careful what you expose your eye to. Look at television. Look at all of these social media networks that we are on. It is what we see there that leads us into things. It is what we watch. And television carries dual. It carries the pictures and adds the sound. So whilst you are watching with the eye, the ear is also hearing. And whilst the ear is hearing and the eye is watching, power. You are being changed into that. Amen. Sometimes if you are not conscious, even we believers, you are not sharp and conscious and stay in the word of God and keep reminding yourself, at a particular time, all of these F and S words, before you know, you are saying them because of your exposure to them. So you ought to protect your eye. Amen. You ought to protect your eye. Job chapter 31, verse 1. Job chapter 31, verse 1. Hallelujah. I have made a covenant with my eyes. Why then should I look upon a young woman? You look. And then your thoughts. And Jesus said that if you look with the intent of grabbing, you have already grabbed. Amen. You look with the intent. You look. Not only is it beautiful that you are giving praise to God, but with the intent of grabbing, you have already grabbed. May God have mercy on us. Amen. So then let's look at the second part of our members that we should tame or dedicate unto God. The ear. Isaiah chapter 50, verse number 4 to 5. We should be hearing the word of God. Isaiah chapter 50, verse number 4 to 5. The Bible says that the Lord God has given me the tongue of the learned, that I should know how to speak a word in season to him who is weary. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to hear as the learned. Amen. So your ear. I always keep saying this. Any preacher who is preaching and cannot confirm the word and is just talking with the word of God, because what you need to grow in your Christian life is the word of God. Amen.
Amen.
And the understanding thereof. That is why we take our time to do this Bible study, so that you would understand. Even when everything is open up and we are doing it in church, we'll still come on live so that those at home who don't actually attend our fellowship would also receive the same word of God that we receive. Amen. Because it is what you hear that will form you. What you hear that will make you or unmake you. Amen. Your ear is not a garbage can for people to come and throw in anything they want. So watch out what you hear, what you listen to. If it will not edify you, stop listening to it. It's not false. Don't forget that when you had not started hearing what the person is saying, you are alive. You did not die. So if the person is saying something that your ear is in contradiction to the word of God, then you should be quick to be able to get yourself off it. Amen?
Amen.
Get yourself from it. Because if you do not, the contamination will keep coming. Amen. May God deliver us from any contamination in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Through our ears. Any contamination. I pray in the name of Jesus. Touch your ears. Any words that have been spoken that you have heard that are not of God, that are seeking to contaminate your system, I rebuke and speak against it. The power of the word of God. May the word of God nullify the effect of that word in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now let's look at the tongue. The tongue. The Bible talks about the fact that the tongue is small and yet he is a troublemaker. The tongue alone is a whole teaching on its own. I'll just rush through it and then we'll bring the teachings to a close. Amen. Let's look at Ephesians chapter number 4, verse number 15. Ephesians chapter number 4, verse 15. You should watch what you say, because many have caused havoc just by what they said, what they spoke. Amen. But speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ. We should speak the truth in love. Even when somebody has done wrong and you're about to talk about it, speak it in love. Amen.
Amen.
Because we are becoming, we are being formed, we are being, all of this transformation I'm talking about, we have a destination. Our destination is to become like Christ. Amen. To become like Christ. Let's look at the verse number 29 of the same chapter. Verse number 29. He says, let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may impart grace to the hearers. When you speak, are people edified? When you speak, are people graced? Do people become uplifted? Or after they have heard you, they become depressed? Words. Wars are started by words. And it is just this small tongue guarded by the 32 teeth. He's there like that. But it's very dangerous. Sets fire in every area if it is not tamed. And it cannot be tamed. You can only tame it by the word of God. Amen. You can only tame it by the word of God. As you allow yourself for the Holy Spirit to work through you and to guide you, then your tongue will be tamed. Amen. Your tongue will be tamed. It's like this. The words you hear, what you see, goes and forms a picture within you. It either causes you to act in a particular way, or it causes you to speak in a particular way. Amen. Whatever you hear, whatever you see, goes into your inner being, your mind. Your mind processes it, and it either comes out through your mouth, the tongue empowering it, in your speech, either to edify or to bring people down. Amen.
Amen.
Or it causes you to act in a particular way. So I pray in the name of Jesus that you would not allow yourself to be polluted by anything that is not of God. May God keep us. May he protect us. May God cause you to only open yourself up by his spirit and through his spirit to things that would edify you. I plead the blood of Jesus over your spirit, over your soul, over your body, that your members will be set apart and dedicated unto God. May you not open yourself up by deeds, by acts, by things you watch, things you hear. I anoint your ears. I ask that your eyes be anointed. Your lips be anointed. Your tongue be anointed. Your feet be anointed. Your hands be anointed. That whatever you do, you would not defile this body, but you rather dedicate it unto God. Before your dedication or whatever you are bringing to God will be accepted, you need to be born again. It is sin that separates us from the love of God and from fellowship with God. Jesus died. He paid the price. All we have to do is to acknowledge what he has done and accept it and apply it to our lives. Without you being born again, all of this dedication of your body, your mind, your spirit unto God, your sacrifice, reasonable sacrifice, is not possible because you are in enmity with God. I want to give you the opportunity. Maybe you are born again. You were having fellowship in church, but you have backslidden. I want to also give you the opportunity to come back to God. You need God. You need him than ever before, even in this time. This is even the right time. You need God than ever before. So I want to help you in prayer. I want to help you, lead you in this prayer. It is your prayer. I'm helping you to pray. Put one hand on your chest. Lift up one hand as a sign of surrender. And let us pray. Say, Lord Jesus, I've heard your word. I believe you came to die for me. You paid for my sins. So forgive me my sins. If you forgive me, I know I am forgiven. Accept me into your kingdom. Make me a new person. Help me to live according to your word by your spirit. Thank you for saving me. Amen. If you said that prayer, you are born again. You are now in the kingdom of God, but you need to grow in the kingdom. You need to grow. Just like when a baby is born, the baby is fed milk, fed food. The same way you need to grow and be fed the food of the word of God. So I will acknowledge, I will admonish you to fellowship, come fellowship with us, Paris Chapel International in Almira. We meet in the Butte House at Kadus every Sunday. And we are online with the Bible studies. Thursdays, we have online teachings. Saturdays, we have prayer sessions. And then Saturday after the prayer sessions, we have our youth teaching service, Bible study service. It's very interactive. I would encourage you. My telephone number is 0617430174. If you are a young adult, a teenager, and you want to be part of this Bible studies, it is a discipleship training, actually. If you want to be part of it, it's non-denominational. We want to help as many as we can help. Just pick my telephone number. Send me a WhatsApp with your details so that I add you to the group so that you can join on Zoom in the comfort of your home and we'll study the word of God together. Your life will never be the same. I believe that God has called us to empower the younger generation so that they would be able to take over and carry this message of the kingdom into all the world. Lack of knowledge, my people perish. Many are in the kingdom joking and thinking they are powerful. You need to sit and be taught the word of God so that you do not act in ignorance. May the Spirit of God empower you and give you grace. Grant you the desires of your heart, the good desires of your heart. And may you continuously desire for the Word of God. Jesus loves you, and so do we. God bless you. Have a wonderful evening and a wonderful weekend. Bye-bye.
You know my name. You know my name. He said, and oh, how you walk with me. Woo! And oh, how you talk with me. I hear you say, oh, how you tell me. And oh, how you tell me. I am your own. Let's say it real loud together. You know my name. You know my name.